what career mistake has given you the biggest lesson?
I mean, other than... Hold up. What up, vlog? We're here in the car on the way to a client Christmas party. I'm gonna answer some questions. Enjoy.
What are some ways to stay focused and manage time without becoming overwhelmed?
Good question. I try to be pretty ruthless on keeping a to-do list separate from my most important thing list. And in Trello, that's just a matter of using two different columns. Sometimes those little tasks can build up and they want to pull at your focus, but we can't forget what the most important things are. The other thing I do is I've started to keep like a separate list for personal things or at home things. So if I've got to pick something up, or I'm just trying to keep things off my mind so I'm not holding the mental space for it.
What one word best sums up you and your vision?
One word. Complicated. Maybe intense? Intense might be wrong, but you know, when it comes to the vision that I have, it's relatively clear to me, and it has required a degree of intensity to pursue that. And then I think even how I am, most everything I do, I think about why I do it or the way that it's done.
What and who inspires you?
I am inspired by passion. When you can just feel the energy in somebody's voice when they talk about something, when somebody's willing to share something that's meaningful, that always inspires me. You know, as far as who, you know, it's easy to be inspired by a big name, Tony Robbins, Elon Musk, somebody who thinks big. Like, the easy thing to do is like, oh, just big, scary things. But to truly be inspired by the janitor who invented Flaming Hot Cheetos because he had this mentality that said, when everybody walks into that room, they're gonna know that I mopped it. And I think that tenacity brought him the opportunity to become the person who invented the Flaming Hot Cheetos. Probably the other person has gotta, I mean, it's gotta be Gary Vee too. I mean, simply because I feel like he speaks his truth and is himself. And as a result of observing him be him, I feel like it's given me greater context or understanding for how I can be myself.
How do you divide your time between delivering ideas and creating them?
Unfortunately, creating them is probably one of the things that gets pushed as a result of sometimes having seasons of heavy workload. Between speaking and consulting, sometimes that capacity for creativity is limited. The one thing that I've been able to do with kind of operating under that constraint is making sure that I have kind of like a foolproof process. So within the last year, probably 6 months, I actually wrote out what is my process, like where, because sometimes you get something, you get a spark, which is always the beautiful part of creating an idea, is the spark of it. But then you'd send yourself an email, you send yourself a text, or you write it in this note, or you jot it in that notebook, and you're never really sure where it is. And so I set up a process that anytime I get a spark, it actually goes right into this one particular Evernote, a notebook. And I set up Evernote that as soon as I press new note, it will default to that. And so then when I do sit down, I'm able to stay much more focused. So in terms of how do I divide my time, I mean, it's tough. One of the things that I enjoy the most is really stepping into the research and letting ideas kind of bounce up against each other and just letting it be this chaos of ideas and going deep and deep and deep and finding myself 2 hours later into this research and then coming back out and saying, how is this usable? But I mean, as of late, spending more time than I would like actually delivering and less on the creating. But at the same time, sometimes the idea gets good, the thinking gets good, and then it's time to execute and trust yourself a little bit.
What is one piece of advice you would give to someone starting out in the speaking industry?
Can you feel the tension? Number one is don't scream at a football game, because then your voice goes away. I would say almost listen to one voice or one expert and execute upon that, because there is no true, real one way into this industry. And you can get kind of caught up or confused in listening to that person and listening to that person, listening to that person, and it just dilutes your focus. But if there is one thing you've got to do, it's you've got to get kind of narrow and specific. Jane Atkinson uses the language, pick a lane. And I think that's got to be just the number one thing. And it's like, well, how do I do that? Great question. Start speaking, listen to your heart, but at the same time, got to deliver tangible, real value in a way that's unique and makes you sticky and something that people can remember. So that's like seven things maybe. And maybe 1A is like, how badly do you want this? How long are you willing to do it? I think maybe the question that can help you say like, am I willing to pick my lane, is would you still want to be talking about this thing in 3 years? Because the message that you start with may actually and will take 3 years to start to get traction, and for most people. And so you need to still have the passion and the fire and the excitement to want to talk about it in 3 years from now, because oftentimes those beginning years, you're not talking about it too much to audiences. You're talking a lot to yourself, but you got to get clear, that focus and that resiliency to just keep getting after it.
What career mistake has given you the biggest lesson?
I mean, other than picking accounting, I mean, I don't feel like I've made any massive career mistakes. But there was a time that the CEO of the company had asked me to abide by a certain dress code, and I did not fully agree with it. And so I did not abide by it as a result. We are in a really hot place, and I thought that shorts were better because it was 100+ degrees out, and we were inside, we were outside, and he had said no to that, and I kept doing it. And then he came back and proceeded to buy me some booty shorts, as that was the pre-arrangement that I would have to wear those. And although at the time, like, it was a funny thing, and in some ways maybe even rallied some of the guys on the floor and I together, it also was like direct disrespect beyond what I was thinking in that moment. I was not thinking about it that way, but it gave me a little bit better perspective on my attitude or how I am, and how that can be a negative impact on others.
What's your favorite meal?
What's my favorite meal? I love a great salad, but that can't be. I feel like my favorite food used to be Mexican, but it's not. My favorite meal would be going to a new restaurant and getting to try 4 to 7 new appetizers. I enjoy that a great deal. What is my favorite meal? I still have a thing for Mexican lasagna that my mom used to make. I've been thinking a lot lately about bronzino, a whole roasted fish. I don't know. I just really love salads. I love a good salad and nachos. Also, barbecue pizza is good too. All right, vlog. Sorry about the voice. Too much yelling in at the really impactful Bills Lions game this weekend. 14-13, a real burner. Hope you enjoyed some of these questions. Let me know if you want to have me answer other questions. We'll talk soon. Bye.